I was actually napping. There's no such thing.
You were we interrupted your nap, Dane?
Yeah, I just need a quick nap.
You can be sleepy.
Sticky Dane needs sleepies.
Ugh, Sticky Dane.
You sound terrible, my friend. I just want to cough.
I want to cough.
All at once.
I want you guys to hear my cough.
No, me, no. Why would you want us to hear
it? It's so bad.
Come on. No, just one.
Give us one cough.
No. Are you sure?
No.
Yes. Yes.
Puff, puff, pass, yo.
Yep. That was.
I don't mean to be insensitive, but can you mute the rest of them, Dane?
Yeah. No, I was. You get one.
Oh, yep. You guys are sick.
Or two.
Well, it's good to have you back, Dane. We missed you, of course. So you don't have any movie trends or anything you want to do to kick off this intro?
I have a Bloody Mary trend.
Dude, I found out the coolest thing.
You can put clam juice in an ice cube tray and make the most amazing Bloody Mary ice cubes. It's really good. Like, that's kind of off whatever, but it's amazing. Warmer the drink gets, the more watered down it should get, the more amazing it gets. Yeah,
dude. Sounds good. I love salt.
It's so good.
You love salt if it's on. Not Keanu Reeves. Tom Cruise.
Johnny Depp.
Salty. You love Johnny Depp's salty.
I love a
arrow beard.
I love a salty Depp.
Salty. You said people have talked about that. Have anybody talked to you about that particular part of the episode?
Not that are close to me.
How far away were they? About 6 inches.
Oh. All right. I'm cutting it. We're starting the show.
Welcome to the official podcast of the Brewmasters Club, Craft Brews, and Geek News. Sit back, pour yourself a pint, and let's get into it. Now here's the founder of the Brewmasters Club and your host, Donnie Gallagher.
Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Brewmasters Club podcast, Craft Brews, and Geek News. My name is Donnie Gallagher. I am the founder and co-host of the Brewmasters Club podcast. I'm joined tonight by somebody who was absent last night, Mr. Dane, feeling a little under the weather. How are you, my friend?
Hey, guys. Yeah, a little under the weather, but happy to be back nonetheless.
Still here for the fans and for the good times. Mr. Louseman is also here today. How are you?
I'm good. I'm technically under the weather, as it is above me, but still good. Not sick yet. Everyone else around me is. So yeah. I'm just going to hope it stays that way.
Okay, good to hear. And Mr. Ryan, how are you, sir?
I am doing fantastic. Thanks for having me on. And as always, a pleasure to join you folks.
So this episode tonight is episode 26, and we are actually not having an ad today. The only ad we're going to have is to ask everybody out there who's enjoying this great content. 26 weeks. Come on, man. That's nearly half a year. That's like 6 months of episodes.
Oh, my God. It is half a year.
It's half a year.
Wow.
So it's been half a year. Thanks for sticking with us. If you're having a great time, visit paypal.me/brewmasters club. You can donate $1, $2, $3, or $100 if you'd like. Let's go for $100. But any little bit helps. And it's just a way that you can kind of say, hey, guys, thanks for what you're doing if you're having a good time. If not, you know, you can still listen, but that's on you. So what we do here on the podcast, as you all know, is that we are going to go into some craft beer news, tidbits, things that are going on in the last week. And then we'll also cover kind of some geeky news, what's going on in pop culture. We did some movie reviews last year. It was the last week of January. So we kind of talked about all the movies coming up in 2017. How well do we think they're going to do? None of us are experts nor movie reviewers professionally. Therefore, our opinions are probably shit. But it was still interesting to hear what everybody had to say. You guys ready to get onto the beer news, or anybody got anything pressing?
Other than that, we were right about XXX, but we'll go into that more later.
Yeah, no teasers, no spoilers there. So just tune into the episode last week, right to the 45-minute mark or so, and you'll be able to hear that review of
XXX. At all. The 45-minute mark? I thought it was like 103 and like change.
Yeah, it was pretty long. It's been a neat and interesting week for beer. There's been two stories that came out that I thought, one of them close to home, the second not so close to home, quite literally. We'll start off with the faraway land here. Basically, there's a competition going on in San Diego. It's called Lab to Moon, and it's basically a group of youth under 20. It's 25 teams under 25. So these teams can range from, you know, American teams, Europeans, the Russians. I mean, it's a worldwide initiative here. And one of the teams in general has a very unique proposition that they're trying to do. The competition is saying, hey, man, if you guys can put together your team and make a science experiment, we'll load it into to a rocket, and we'll send it up into outer space and into the moon, essentially, if that's where the mission ends up going. But so they're doing things like, can plants grow in space? Can you water plants in space? Can you make a pizza in space? I mean, these don't necessarily have to be practical, you know, applications, but interesting applications. Some of the more far out ones, they didn't even really like list them here and kind of what they're, I'm on the website, which is basically labtomoon.teamindus.in. So Team Indus is the organization ultimately that's putting this on, but this is kind of, some of these profiles range from, like I said, all over the world, really. But there are 25 teams that have been shortlisted. Things like assembling structures with zero gravity or zero energy, bacteria growth in space, radiation shield using bacteria, a lot of bacteria, which is just cool. The germination of greens. Yeah, kind of gross. Effective plant growth on the moon. But the one we came to talk about, the one that we are here to talk about, is one called Original Gravity. Not David Matt. No, this team is called Original Gravity, and their goal is to try to brew beer on the moon using yeast.
Hell yeah.
So essentially, and if you think about it, we talk about Original Gravity because that's how beer is made, right? As Ryan and I figured out when we made the Spartan Kick, you know, yeast kind of weights down, or the internal heavy pieces of your beer will kind of sink to the bottom. The yeast creates gas and alcohol, and that kind of floats above the kind of muck that's on the bottom when you're done brewing your beer. Well, what happens without gravity? Is it all just kind of static in the air? Is there something that might happen or might not happen? They've got a video all about kind of what they expect and what their experiment is going to be about. It'll be really interesting to see what happens kind of when this competition goes out. I don't even know the day that this is going to be called. But again, if you Google Original Gravity, you'll kind of find a little bit more about it. So I know it's happening this year. They said in 2015, they're flying to the moon and they're going to carry one experiment aboard their spacecraft. I'm sure there's a way that we can influence this by letting this group know that we really want to see this go. Or I've actually reached out to these guys, try and get them on the podcast, just to talk about their project, because I think it's extremely interesting. But out of 15 countries, 300 cities, these guys are in the top 25. So it's pretty cool, and I'll start yammering, but what do you guys think about that?
Better. Can we call it zero gravity beer?
I guess you could.
Blue Moon is already taken. So
they're not sending in their letter to Disney, are they?
No.
Because they're done. That's the case.
Sending in their letter to Disney?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
They're the most enthusiastic, but...
Right. Oh, geez. Okay. Dane's referencing our interaction with some of the folks at Lucasfilm and the podcast. So Disney is staying away from anything beer, which we understand, and that's fine. And that's okay. It's not right, but it's fine. I'm sorry.
They're probably the coolest. They're probably the coolest, most enthusiastic, but it's beer, so they'll get shut down.
Yeah,
we're going to back them.
We are going to back them. And when I was looking through this article, I kept thinking to myself, I was like, all I could think about was the yeast. I had compassion for the yeast. Like, what are those little fuckers going to be doing up there in space? Like, trying to swim around, make beer. Like, I'm sure they've got some sort of anti-gravity thing, but...
But, no, well, think about it. It's not in a vacuum when we brew beer, but essentially there's no oxygen, and the only air in there is being produced by the yeast, which means it expels all the other air that was in there. So do they need oxygen?
Do you need to sterilize the entire thing? That's probably part of the deal, but I just kept thinking about them up there, you know, turning it all into alcohol and swimming around, having the time of their lives. It was just, I don't know.
they don't need to sink to perform. They'll react to, you know, the sugars and the glucose that's in there, pending that it's all mixed up and ready to go. You know, if you just dump it on top, you might find a problem, but I'm assuming they would have this worked out in a zero G testing environment. So,
oh yeah, no, I totally get that. I just thought maybe I was thinking more on like the humorous side of things of like, what would it be like for those yeast in space? That was all.
On the humorous side, Lost, why don't you clue us into your yeasty conversation?
Of course. First thoughts initially here, where did the potato clock fall on scientific experiments sent to the moon?
Are they not on top 25?
Top 50, maybe top 100, because I feel like they're a little underrepresented. But beyond that, beyond imagining a potato clock sitting on the moon by itself, it would be telling the moon time, just so we're clear, but whatever. beyond that, this is it's pretty cool. I mean, I can't help but think they're sending like a whole like self-contained fermenting kit and brewing kit like all the way up there so it can brew. And then like, what would it do when it got there? Would it just like be like spray beer everywhere, or like that's just, I'm curious, like it being able to go up there, whatever it, you know, self-contained, maybe it's like a micro satellite or something like that, to like go up there and do its thing and brew some beer.
Well, it's going to be, you know, it's going to be just like aboard a cargo area, and I think they'll load it and they'll send it and they'll bring it back and try to record what's happening in it. I don't know how they could do that. Or perhaps, yeah, you know, the astronauts can interact with it when the experiment's done. But I mean, think about how long beer takes, right? You got a 3 weeks, 4 weeks. I mean, it could take quite a bit. I think what they're just trying to do is to see in a short time if alcohol could be created. Honestly, with the oxygen that's cleaned and scrubbed and put in the spacecraft, if they were to use oxygen from the spacecraft without gravity and the yeast still functions producing CO2, which might be dangerous for the astronauts, there really shouldn't be any complication in that except agitating the beer, in my opinion, but what do I know?
What if they're just brewing it up there so they can pour a little out for all the fallen astronauts? Homies?
I mean, maybe that's an option.
That's because, well, what are they going to do with a bunch of beer up there? I mean, I guess all the astronauts can drink it, but then they'll have to go pee and they have to share their space body. Like, that doesn't make, none of that checks out.
No, I agree with
you. Have
you
heard about space bodies?
No.
Please tell them and let things. This is happening. You don't just sit on them and like kind of do your business. It's like, it's a small vacuum the whole time.
That's on your ween.
And then they cut it off and done. Kind of like a boat, but weirder.
I know that I learned this on Star Talk podcast, that they actually jettison pee from the astronauts into space and it becomes crystallized and shoots off like a beautiful chandelier breaking in slow motion.
Yep. That's wow. Interesting. That's always romantic.
Yeah. Well, you know me. You guys have anything else on this? Because the next story we have is also this, you know, this episode 26 is science episode. Welcome to science episode, everyone. Thanks for joining us.
Science talk.
Anybody, don't lie.
Yeah. Anybody got anything else with that?
No, I wish them luck, man. I hope it's a success.
Yeah. Yeah, me too. It seems pretty cool. So the next story that I found is there that we pulled out here was for the another beer, you know, of course, story. And again, science related. And this is the one that I said, remember I said it, there's one that hits home and there's one that's far from home. So we've got the moon far from home, and then we've got UCF that's right down the road about 50 miles from here, 30 miles from Laos, that are actually, you know, doing something pretty incredible with beer too. Basically, you know, UCF already has a Cicerone class and has, you know, beer kind of biologist, you know, type of classes and degrees available. But this is a little bit different. There's a new program. I forget the doctor's name who started it, but essentially what they're trying to do is they're trying to refine and perfect the way that, you know, combating microbes. So Ryan, you brought up a great question. You said, how do they clean the beer? How do they do things like that? Are the vessels and the tubing? This is what these kids are trying to figure out. It's extremely unique, and it's a cool beer scene in Orlando and Tampa here. But these students are actually working with local breweries to improve the way that the microbes are fought. So microbes can affect anything from the vessel itself, the brewing containers, the tubes that you use to transfer beer into a bottle or a pint glass through your tap lines. If you've ever been to a bar before where the beer is really skunky, well, I also remember this story from our trip up to North Carolina. Beer tasted like rotten ass. It was awful.
Ugh.
It was sour, and it was literally like a Yingling. I mean, it was awful. But
it was also a dollar.
Yeah, it was, that's true. It was also a dollar. but there's a chemical called dextrocetaphil that can affect your beer, and it's basically just a bacteria that grows from microbes, and it's just a series of using taps and plumbing and not cleaning it properly, and it can give you a buttery flavor that really messes with your beer, and then it'll eventually just make it skunked completely, and it's a shame. So just nasty. But these guys are doing this for college. I mean, their end goal is to help improve this technology, of course, and using their degrees before they're even out of college. So that's cool too. But then imagine the possibilities once you're out of this, gone through this program, and you really understand the chemistry behind what makes beer bad. That type of knowledge is huge. Think of, we heard it at 81 Bay when the guys talked about losing that batch of beer that was, you know, 660 gallons or so. That was thousands of dollars of revenue out of their pockets, because it didn't seal right, they didn't do it at the right time, and the bacteria actually affected the beer. So things like that, man, this could be huge. I mean, how badass would that be if that was your college degree?
It's like that class in eighth grade where you're getting ready to build a rocket, and the day before, the teacher rolls in that giant TV with the VHS. He's like, all right, for the 10th time, we're going to watch October Sky. And you're like, fuck yeah. So this is that class, but in early 20s, you know. Working on beer sounds awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah. You go home, you drink, you watch October Sky, and you're like, this is like fourth grade again.
Your teacher hands you a beer, and then
wait, and you build a rocket beer, and then you realize
you
just
send it to space so that you can see if you can brew it on the moon.
There you go. It all ties in.
It all ties in. Yeah. It all works together. I think it's great. Anything to help improve the quality. And the
shelf life.
Shelf life. I mean, help craft breweries and help them brew better beer. You know, get a better experience out of it. I think that I'm completely for it. I hope they find something that we didn't already know, or they find ways to help improve it, which it seems like they already are. But yeah, I'm all for it.
Well, I mean, sounds, you know, good. For centuries, people have used bleach to clean things, but now we have bleach that's safe for your baby and bleach that's safe, you know, or stronger for your toilet. Don't confuse those. You know, I mean, there's always a way you can improve something. So yeah, they're working off a foundation, but you know.
Well,
yeah,
I mean, cool. Maybe they find a different type of sanitizer that would work better to interact with the beer. Because, you know, some people that are home brewers, they won't brew unless they sanitize then rinse. And some brewers are like, no, you can just sanitize and that's it. You don't have to rinse. Maybe there's something they can determine that there's an effect on the beer of some degree, or who knows, maybe they can make better sanitizer. You know, we'll see. I think that's great. Kudos.
Yep. Yep. Anything else on that?
No.
Alrighty then. We are moving. We're moving quickly tonight, but that's, again, because we gave everyone so much great content last week that we're trying to go through pretty quickly. And also, we've got young Master Dane here that we don't want to exhaust. He's not feeling well. So this is for you, Dane. How are you feeling now?
Lovely. Keep having to mute myself, but it's all good.
Have you had to work in the last 2 weeks?
yeah, I've been at work all this week. Last week, I was at home.
You just like got the sniffles while like rappelling out of a helicopter. <You're> like, yeah, yeah. And then you're like, okay, bye.
Yeah, go see the doc. Ah, sir. Yeah, you got the flu. Go home.
Well, hopefully you feel better soon, man. Because we were all thinking about you last week, and we're happy to have you back.
Yeah, glad to be back.
But, moving right along, what we go into now is our what you drinking, what you gonna drink. I never really start off ever, but I want to start off with this one because I brought our good friend back, Mr. New Belgian. I love the New Belgians. I always have. And nothing against our current unofficial sponsor. They're great. I love them too. Sierra Nevada is still getting some flack for what happened with their, you know, little debacle earlier a week or week and a half ago. But they're also winning some awards and just got recognized as one of the, I think, the fourth best brewery in the nation. They're still making good headlines. So this beer is pretty awesome. It is the cherry almond, like I said, and it is just to die for. I like it. It's got a subtle hint of cherry, more almond really than anything else, but it's just an all-around good beer. Has anybody had it?
Negative.
I think I tasted it one time and I just was like on board for half of it and just completely off foot by the rest.
I believe you were more like, oh no, that's just gross. You thought it was okay. You thought it was a little much.
Yeah.
See, I think it's almost perfect because it gives you just a little bit of that. It looks, it's got a ruby red kind of mahogany color to it. When you drink it, it's got like a little bit of coffee, a little bit of roasted malt, a little chocolate. You do get some cherry in there, but it's almost like a mix of cherry and like cherry cola, you know. It's a slight smoky tinge to it, but it's sweet throughout, and it leaves a nice kind of, not a porter finish, but more like a brown or something. So it finishes pretty good. It's got a relatively thick body and about 6% alcohol. So definitely suggest it if you see it out there. But I just wanted to kick it off because I'm really like loving this right now. Sorry, Laos. I'm sure you're, you know, not.
Yeah, I still continue to dislike it, but that's, hey, to each his own.
Well, what do you got, Lausman?
So I have something that I've had my eye on for quite the hot minute. I got the bomber variety right here. I've got the Fat Tug, which when I say it like that, geez, Sounds weird and gross.
I'm sorry. is that
no a stories good fat there? Tug?
it's decent. actually, I really enjoy it. So it's made by Driftwood Brewing.
We all enjoy a good tug every now and again, Laos.
No relation.
Especially some of us. Tug and
some of us more than others.
Thanks, you had your eye on that Fat Tug for a while.
back to your beer.
I did have one. Yeah, back to my beer. So it's made by Driftwood Brewery, and they're based out of British Columbia, Canada. So pretty cool. You know, it's technically imported. It's an IPA, 80 IBUs and 7% ABV. So it's a little towards the higher end there. It's got a neat little label on it. It's pretty good. The one thing that kind of struck my eye on this one was it's got grapefruit in it a little bit. And it's got, how do they phrase it? Well, it's got melon in it and then also restrained malt notes. I think they're pretty outlandish at myself. I mean, I think they're not really restrained. I can taste a lot of malt in it, so don't really know what that means. What does that mean, Donnie?
It just means that you can feel it there, but it's not overpowering. Just holding back a little bit, but sounds pretty good, man. Anything else in that bad boy?
Nope, nothing. That it's just a bomber, so could be enjoying it for quite a hot minute here.
Dane, I don't want to save you for last, but I'm assuming that you're not drinking much right now.
Correct. But I might have to jump on this tug train, so.
Oh, back on the wagon, as they say, I guess. Oh, go ahead.
I can send one up
not,
there for you,
not
buddy.
Not in the alleyway, but.
Oh, yeah. Lord.
Oh, there, tugger.
Hey there, tugger. go for it, Ryan.
All right, so I do want to give a quick shout out to Sierra Nevada because I actually had one of their beers. I know they've been catching a lot of flack lately, but I had the Beer Camp Golden IPA tonight. I did check the bottle. It was brewed and bottled within that time phase that they were asking people to send all of their stuff back. But I did a little straining first just to make sure there was no glass. It was a fantastic beer and the wife loved it. So I do want to give a shout out to them. But the beer that I brought to actually share is this nice golden red. If you can see that here on the podcast, watching that, it's beautiful. And it is the Dogfish Head, Flesh and Blood IPA. And it is fantastic. It's definitely got everything that's on the side of the can here, brewed with orange peel, lemon, and fresh orange juice. So it's got a lot of citrus flavors into it, and they use a Warrior and Centennial hop, which is what they searched for a very long time before they actually started to brew this beer. Fantastic. If you can get it, totally recommend it. It is a very full flavor and very citrusy style IPA, but it also finishes very malt forward at the same time. So I love it.
I want to say that was one of the ones that was included in their 17 lineup. And that was one of the brand new ones that came out. I could be wrong, but is that?
I think you're right.
No, well, it sounds very familiar, well could have been. Maybe
we just went over it before.
It is a newer beer, but they've started brewing it in 2016. So I'm not sure. Maybe this was like maybe that list that we talked about. It was on there. Yeah.
Yeah, they weren't all new. It was just Dogfish Head releasing what they were going to brew. Remember, it was just the schedule. It wasn't all brand new.
Right. And to kind of go off of that, it could have been that, you know, even though it was brewed in 2016 to start, they might have just been trying to get a following and now they're nationally releasing it. So
I want to look it up.
A shout out. It's so
I want to look it up because I believe specifically, now that I'm remembering it, you actually, Ryan, said, you're like, hey, I really want to try that.
Maybe I did.
I really want to try that Blood Orange.
It was a couple weeks ago, but it's yeah. really good. I bought two, so I'm not going to drink them both.
Episode 19. When somebody gets a moment, take a look at episode 19 and
episode
let me know.
Episode 19. Got it.
Yeah, if anybody can find that clip, that hot clip from Ryan, and we'll bring it back. Some of the more interesting ones. Of course, the 120s on here. The Flesh and Blood IPA was a first run in 2016. So now they brought it on full time. Did any of you guys have the Flesh and Blood IPA from
Dogfish? No, but I definitely want to try it.
Yeah. I mean, I love all of their IPAs. They're really good. So I'd be interested to see what the difference is between that one and the – well, I know that the 90 and the 60 and the 120, the difference is they're continually hopped, which is always just like a super spicy beer, which is great. But I would love to taste that Flesh and Blood to see what that is.
So hot.
Hot.
I like that.
Fat tug.
Like a sizzle noise. Dude, okay, new sound bit coming up. I'm in the works. Right. I'm in the studio.
All right, you're in the studio?
Yep, I'm in the studio making up hot clip beats and, you know, fat tug tweets.
Okay.
Well, on that note, let's go ahead and move on. And if you don't have anything else, Ryan, then we can move on
to shower beer now.
Shower beer.
Grab a glass one.
So, real quick, just want to put, before we move on to our geek news, just want to put another shout out for Florida Craft Beer Day. Please participate. Hashtag on Instagram or Twitter, FLCBD2017. So, hashtag Florida Craft Beer Day, or just retweet what we say. Essentially, what we're trying to do is to get some chatter going on. And if you actually are able to go ahead and tweet that, I'll put a video here on this, but you can essentially be right up on our homepage for the event itself. So really, truly have your voice heard. We're getting thousands of hit on that site right now because we're so close to the Florida Craft Beer Day. People are going nuts over it. So we're getting picked up on media. I'll be talking on actually the Central Florida PBS station on Monday. We have an interview with Amy, one of the reporters there, for a blog, and for WEDU, which is the local station. So very cool stuff, but it's definitely catching some steam, and we are less than 2 weeks away. So
that's awesome.
It's really exciting. But that's all, you know, that's all I'll say about the Florida Craft Beer Day on the Geek News. There is a Rogue One update, which even though the movie's gone and we all loved it. Release date, April 4th. What do you guys think about that? Think that's too early, too late? I saw it online. I think it was the Star Wars News Net, but I'm not sure.
For the DVD and Blu-ray?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's pretty quick.
Very quick.
Awesome. That's real quick.
Awesome.
That's real quick. Well, considering they already dropped the title for episode 8, I don't doubt that it's happening, but
– I mean, if they're ready, I mean, why not?
Yeah.
I mean, they make movies so fast these days, and then they release them. It's – I mean –
yeah,
I'd wait till summer, like a little bit closer to summer, you know, right when.
Well, before summer, they're going to have Celebration. So you're saying like wait towards past that because Celebration comes out right after this launch. Why not boost up Celebration by, you know, playing it up at Celebration? Who's got their copy to Rogue One or whatever? I mean, at Star Wars Celebration.
So they're releasing it after?
They're releasing it about 2 weeks before because Celebration's on April.
I say, yeah. I mean, they, if they would have played it right, they should have done it like at the event. You know,
yeah.
That could have been one of the things, like one of the perks.
I would assume that would be a cool perk of doing it like that. But I bet they did it for just another week or two of press before the Celebration. That's all
to kind of build into it and
build into it. Yeah, yeah. You slow drip out stories so you have, you know, consistent stories. I don't know. That's what the PR guy again to me. So
I mean, I believe it.
So, yeah. Sounds good either way. I can't wait to see it. You guys gonna pick it up?
No doubt.
YARP
means yes.
Yeah, me too. So Dane,
we know what YARP means.
I mean, everyone got real quiet and I'm like, okay, go watch.
I had to take a sippy, man. I had to take a sippy.
I thought maybe you were waiting for me to say if I was gonna get it. Of course I'm gonna get it. So
and everyone gets
Ryan's,
it. Come on,
Ryan's
now.
A diehard fan now.
I love that one.
Hot fuzz.
We were all drunk.
I like hot fuzz too.
All right, good. So Dane, the next one, again, another another little bit of Star Wars news, just because we didn't hit it hard enough last one, last podcast. But I think Dane, you're the only one. I've played a hot second of this, but I believe you're the only one who's played Battlefront. Is that correct? The new Battlefront?
Yes, I've played it.
The new one.
Have you played it, Lossman?
No, I have not. I did stand behind a small Brazilian child for about 20 minutes waiting to play it at GameStop one time, though.
Okay. I'm glad you had the GameStop there part because it was getting a little wonky.
Glad you knew he was at least Brazilian.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Well, I felt the need to change the language on the thing, and I was like, great, you ruined it, even if I do get a turn. But I had other things to do that day, so.
Para de la rebellion.
It was a rough day.
Yeah, all right. Well, Ryan, I'm guessing you haven't played it?
Can't say that I have. I'm sorry.
So, Dane, just because you probably have – Dane has, I think, again, the most knowledge. So, Dane, I'm just going to give my perception of what I thought the first one was, and then you give me yours because you actually have experience, and then we'll kind of dive into the news piece of this. Essentially, I loved the graphics. I liked how intense it was, the explosions, the fighting things, the characters you could play. It seemed like a lot of fun. The scenarios, the settings, I understand there was the DLC that pissed everybody off because once you bought the game, then you had to actually buy all this other stuff just to play the game, which is bullshit. I get that. But rising above, you know, talking the higher pros and cons of it, you know, what was your stake on it from being a Star Wars fan?
It was not very good.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, it was very beginning of it was cool. It was fun. But it got boring very quickly. And very repetitive.
Yeah, repetitive.
Yep.
Heard that.
So I know what they're – go ahead, Donnie.
Go ahead. You take – so kick off the second article here. Tell us what this is.
Yeah, so the sequel is going to have a single-player campaign, and it's going to have multiple eras. There's two big complaints with the very first one. Pandemic Studios games – they're absent in the reboot. There's a playable era aside from the Galactic Civil War and a single-player campaign. Those are the two big issues. You're just fighting in one era, and it was multiplayer. So they're going to come out with different eras and a single campaign that will follow different eras. And I think that's going to make a lot more people happy. So we'll see where they go with it. It was a total disaster, the very first one.
Yeah. I remember, but the funny thing is, Lost Man, that was the Battlefront that you and I played hours of, man, the first two for Xbox. We played the hell out of those games, man. And that's what did. They had multiple eras, and you had different stuff, and you had campaign and multiplayer. I mean, it was badass.
My favorite was either the online or the and we would play this all the time, actually. Me, you, and Chet Fulton. We'd play this all the time. It would be the Galactic Conquest, where you would play almost like a game of chess, and you would move across the galaxy, and then if the game progressed long enough, across different like eras. So it was an evolving game, and it involved a lot of piling in, which was his favorite. And basically, you would just progress across a galaxy, and you would pick what time period you wanted this to be, what kind of troops you wanted to, you know, it was pretty in depth for the time period. I mean, we're talking PlayStation 2, Xbox 360, and then eventually PlayStation 360, or sorry, PlayStation 3, and, you know, Xbox, and all that jazz. But yeah, in any event, great little game back in the day. What they did with this one, I don't really know, but I do know that the little insight I have is they let DICE only create this most recent Battlefront. So that might have been the issue. DICE might have just focused a little too much on their expertise on online gameplplay. So they might ran away with it.
The game was rushed.
Yeah.
It was rushed.
But does DICE make Call of Duty, or which one do they make? Modern Warfare?
Battlefield.
They make Battlefield, which is something that me and Dane are quite
proficient,
well-versed.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you have some insight on that, yeah.
Okay. Well, it's good, man. Either way, I almost bought the Xbox One when I was like, I have to play this Battlefront game. And then on that one, unlike our next article here, I didn't roll dice on the Xbox One just because I didn't need to play anything else. I only wanted to play Battlefront, and apparently Battlefront sucked a bag of dicks. So,
yep.
Yeah, so it's kind of depressing because I think the fandom was there and was ready for it and was itching for it, but they just didn't get it. So hopefully the second one's a lot better.
Yeah, hopefully they can redeem themselves for sure. We'll see.
From what I can see in some other articles that I've read over and stuff like that, they hope it's going to take more of an approach like Battlefield 1 has, which is where they're talking about almost the same type of conflict, but we're talking about several different theaters. That's kind of the Battlefield 1 approach. So like their World War One based video game, which, you know, they show Europe, they show North Africa, they show areas.
Sit those jackasses down and make them play Battlefront 2 all the way through, and they'll be like, oh, let's just do this. That's all we need.
If they make a brand new version that's got good graphics of old school Battlefront 2, let's just do
that. Yeah, that'll be great. That'll be great. So awesome. Well, hopefully Battlefront. The sequel is badass. Speaking of rolling the dice, taking away all Ryan's segue points. Ryan, I'm sorry. Did you have anything on Battlefront? We just left you on mute.
Sounds awesome.
So, speaking of rolling the dice, I did roll the dice on the Switch. Of course, I'm telling you all now that it will be at my house on March 3, along with a fresh, steamy copy of Breath of the Wild. So, I plan on fully playing that for the next 48 hours after receiving it on the 3rd of March. And we had a little bit of Switch news in the last week. And so because I rolled the dice on this one, unlike Battlefront 1, I'll bring it to you guys. They basically told us, today, this is an article from Polygon, and they said there's 100 launch titles that are coming to the Switch the day the Switch is available. So that is a plethora of titles. Now, are those going to be top tier games or indie games or little shit games that are, like basically upgraded cell phone games? I don't know. But Kimishima had a couple quotes on this. Essentially what he said is that after the presentation on January 13th, they continued to receive requests for more and more software publishers who want to develop games for the system. So at the presentation, they announced that there are over 80 games in development with 50 software publishers. That number has now climbed to over 100 titles from 70 publishers. So odds are we're going to get a lot more games coming out than we thought we would. Are we going to get them at launch? Probably not. And they haven't even bothered to announce them in terms of titles yet. So it's a cool thing. I mean, what do you guys think about that? More games, of course. Did you see this coming, or does anybody think this is unusual that they got this influx of games that they've now announced are coming?
Yeah, I think it's crazy. Do we all remember like the back of the box on a Nintendo 64 where it was like Banjo-Tooie and another game? It was like, what? Or Banjo-Kazooie, I guess, at that point. Yeah, it was like you saw like 8 different games, and like Perfect Dark was all over the place, and you were like, this will be amazing forever. And then it was like, oh, okay, there's more than 8 games out there. That's pretty neat.
yeah, so there better be, right? Not surprising.
Yeah.
I hope the third-party games will be good. If there's going to be like Call of Duty, Battlefield, I don't think people will stray away from the Xbox and PlayStation for that. But I think there'll be maybe 5 to 10 really great titles that us as Nintendo players are used to and are looking forward to. But out of 100, it's going to be a bunch of little random games here and there, I think.
I'm with you on that. Raga?
I think a lot of people are going to start off playing the Zelda and just let that carry them through until they release Mario later in the year.
And that's kind of what he went on to say. You know, they have this weird strategy with the 2007 software lineup. So they're just trying to put out new titles regularly without long gaps, which as a gamer, I guess that's great. Unless, like Ryan just said, you're a selective gamer. Like, I'm not going to buy every – I'm not that much of a Nintendo fanboy. Well, I'm just going to go out there and buy everything because I want to. You know, some of those games I think are fun, but they're kind of like I'll play them for a weekend and then I'll show them off to people. Kind of like we did with Wii Sports, you know. Like, Wii Sports was fun because you could actually sit down and hammer that shit out. And it was fun to do. But if they have these gimmicky games, they kind of lose that fun.
Well, and they might start off that way, but some of them, I mean, when you're talking about 100 different titles at one point, I think some of them will catch on in a different fashion than what some people think. So, I mean, there's going to be a lot of games that people like start talking about, start playing a lot, and that's going to happen. But the two that most, I think everybody's got on their mind the most is the two that we just talked about, Zelda and Mario. So we'll see. Maybe they throw a Donkey Kong in there or something.
Yeah, and there's a couple. They said, like you said, Ryan said that Zelda's going to be launch day, but the Mario Kart 8, which people are really looking forward to, is not coming out until sometime in the first half of the year, so summertime. Splatoon 2, which I never played the first one because I didn't have a Wii U, but I heard it's really fun. That's coming out in the summer. What I thought was interesting is that in this same interview, he actually named names and listed numbers, which Nintendo is nefarious for not doing, NES Classic. But they specifically said that Nintendo plans to ship 2 million units of the console worldwide by the end of March. That's awesome. I mean, that's not even a lot. You know what I mean? I'm on the pre-order list, but I'm assuming you guys aren't.
Not yet.
No. I'm going to have a fresh, steamy diaper on my front porch on March 3rd. So,
yeah.
Not a sweet Nintendo. Sorry,
yeah.
I've been leaving those on your front porch. Sorry about that. But
those aren't very sweet smelling at all. Those are the worst that you will ever experience.
So, he's just trying to get Dane some practice.
I really want one, but I don't know when I'm going to get it.
Well, don't worry. We'll do the podcast. We can do some commentary. You can stream over the shoulder and watch us all having so much fun with it. We can talk about it. And when you come back from leave, well, you know, you can play with my Switch. just to wrap it up. Joe, talk about your Duggar. Good one. That was a good one. Just to wrap it up with the Nintendo Switch conversation, again, they just went on to reiterate that they've closed pre-orders, and a lot of retailers have, and that they're allocating their remaining factors. So I don't know what that would even look like. And I don't know, Ryan, if you have an idea just from a managing inventory standpoint, if you had 2 million that are shipping that whole month, it's supposed to drop on March 3rd. I mean, you've got to assume that they saved 5-10% for pre-orders. There's no way that they're pre-ordering more than they're going to expect to sell in retailers. For
it's
that whole
fly.
Month.
Yeah, it's going to fly. I mean, look how fast the retro one that just came out.
But the retro one's different, man, because it's a much easier price point.
Yeah.
Much easier price point, games included, and you're appealing to a nostalgia factor that the Switch will not have. You'll have the fanboys.
But you've been building up the Switch around all that. I mean, you saw how quickly those other ones sold, and then even eBay and like people that bought them, they're like, oh, I'm just gonna sell this for $500, and people were buying them just to get them. So
yeah, it's also Christmas though. I mean, that was very intelligent.
This has got a much bigger build-up, and I think that everybody wants to again play that Zelda game. Everybody loves Zelda, and I really feel like I don't think it's going to be a question in a lot of people's mind. I think they're just going to drop $300 and go for it. So
sign me up.
You already did.
Yeah. So,
I don't need to sell you. You already sold yourself. You're good.
No, I know. I'm an apologist for Nintendo regardless. So I don't need to be sold. I mean, I was this close to buying a Wii. My Wii was still working at the time. So
I was wondering where that was going.
Come on, Dad, Tugga.
No way.
Man, the old tug job just never leaves the conversation, does it? Just always right there waiting for you.
Old reliable. Old reliable.
Sitting in your pocket.
Look at that fat tug.
Oh, Jesus.
Nice can.
Anything else?
What a great can. Anything else?
You guys got anything else on the Switch before we kind of wrap things up? Again, told you quick, trying to get Dane out of here. We don't want this guy to faint.
Wrap it up.
Quick. I got one more thing.
Yeah, man.
Okay. The only thing, just to touch on what Dane said, I don't think they're actually going to go the route where they have before, where they produce, Battlefield 1 or any, you know, Call of Duty or anything like that. I really hope they just say, you know what, we're kind of done with those titles. I hope they just say, those kind of just aren't for our clientele. They're just not what we're into. And that's how this whole thing started. They were like, hey, we got Mario. Hey, we got our games. We got our lineup. And, you know, PlayStation and Xbox, they kind of did their own thing. Now, you know, I think only through consumerism have Xbox and PlayStation aligned and been like, you know what, let's sell the same game. I kind of hope Nintendo Switch is just like, nah, we're cool. Like, we're going to drop like a sweet Bomberman or something like that.
They have Bomberman's the launch title.
Yep.
Sweet.
Yep.
I do have a note about that though, because it's a devil's advocate opposite school of thought from what you are, Lawson. And this is what I strongly feel is going to happen. If I'm someone who's a Nintendo fanboy, I mean, think about it. It's damn near $400. So these aren't kids, you know, that love Nintendo games, that love Pokemon and stuff. These are adults that are going to be purchasing this primarily, people that can afford it. Who if you give me the option. I don't have Call of Duty. I'm not good at it. I don't have an Xbox or an Xbox One or a PlayStation. But if I did, and they said, well, here's Call of Duty 1 or whatever it's called, and you can get it on the PlayStation and play it in your living room on amazing graphics with all your friends, or you can get it on the Switch and play it on the toilet like their last commercial had, or play it in the car or on a plane or out in the street or remotely with your friends wirelessly at school or wherever, I'm buying the one that I can take with me on the go, because that's exactly what I want to do with it. I don't want to have to be tethered to my TV to play my Call of Duty. I think that they will, if that choice is presented to someone, and if for DICE or whoever it is that makes those games, why wouldn't you capitalize on that? Because you're saying, hey, these guys are going to buy this game like crazy now that it's available on the Switch, because they can physically take the game with them. I think that's going to be a huge selling point for where the people say, am I going to buy the Xbox One or the Switch? Well, I can take my Call of Duty with me. I'm going Switch. Same thing for those titles. Buy it for the PlayStation 1 to have at home, or buy it on the Switch and take it with me. I'm buying it for the Switch to take it with me. I think that's my personal opinion.
That's fair. I just think, you know, we don't need a screaming COD fanboy on the bus. Like, we don't need that. Like, as a nation, we just, as a world, we don't need someone to be like, come on! Like, just screaming and just... And people do that with their handhelds, but they do that more with Call of Duty.
Yeah, so... Did you have something on that, Dana Ryan?
I was just going to say, are they going to do anything with Mega Man, Ninja Turtles, or Star Fox, because that would be awesome.
Guaranteed. Yeah, I guarantee that's coming.
Yeah. I loved Star Fox as a kid. That was part of my childhood. So I hope the hell they do that.
Cousin Ann Ross.
Thanks, Fox. I thought they had me.
Shoot the link like a screw.
Slippy, that little jackass.
That's what we should have done, is Fox Star Fox quotes to start the show. Maybe next time.
There are four.
I got to tell you, though, I'm about to be 30, and my brain does not remember, like, when I was six at all. But I can't remember what he said, but it was an awesome game.
We'll look up some quotes, and that'll be our blooper reel for the start of it. Maybe we get some costumes going. It'll be great. That's a great segue if you guys want anything else. What to look forward to next week?
Star Fox.
Anything else before we move into that?
Star Fox gibberish.
Sweet Star Fox gibberish. Starbucks Star Fox. Perfect. Gibberish. And it'll be February, which it technically is maybe now.
It's already February.
Either way, more Switch news, more going on. We'll be 1 week closer to Florida Craft Beer Day, so we'll have some updates there. Tune in. We appreciate you guys for listening. Again, just one way to contribute, since you do not have a sponsor for this week, visit paypal.me/brewmastersclub. You can put $1, $2, $3 would be a superstar. If everybody that's listening put $3 in, we'd have at least $16. It would be great. It would really help us out.
All right. That's a six-pack.
That six pack, yeah, right. See, then we could buy some more beer. It'd be awesome. So if you want to contribute to the show, please do that. As a big thank you. This is a half year, 6 month mark. We will see hopefully how many more 6 months we can make. I'm guessing quite a few. If you want to talk to the show, you want to pitch us some questions, say, hey guys, I'd love to hear your thoughts on this, simply use the hashtag Brewmasters Club, or you can tweet to us directly. I am available on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and you can find us on YouTube at Brewmasters Club. Louseman, where can they find you?
The popular people out there can find me at Mr. Louseman. I'm always there spitting ramblings and things of henceforth and so on.
But of course, Mr. Ryan.
You guys can find me on Twitter as well at BrewedBoy813.
You're quite active on Twitter. I'm liking your Twitter game, man.
I'm actually surprised that my Twitter game is where it's at. So,
yeah, well, good for you.
It's there.
Mr. Dano.
Twitter at DT Mirt.
And if you,
and
if
sentence.
You can, if you can tweet Dane some vitamin C and some A to zinc vitamins, you know, that'd be helpful because he needs it right now. But sound like you're getting better, man.
Yeah.
I'm all, right. All the way up.
All the way up. All right, good. And on that note, we're going to go all the way out. Thank you guys once again. We love you. Have a great night. Be safe and be well. Goodbye.
Cheers.
Late.
You've been listening to the official podcast of the Brewmasters Club, Craft Brews, and Geek News. Grab a beer with the guys and be sure to subscribe to catch additional content. Add this podcast to your favorite RSS feed or iTunes. Chat with the guys on Twitter at Brewmasters Club and Facebook and online at www.brewmasters.club. Cheers!